And welcome to the first annual Kenyan Lecture in Religious Education. My name is Dr. James Ginther, and I am the Dean of the Faculty of Theology, and I welcome you to this event. Before we begin, I'd like to invite Father Mary D'Souza of the Congregation of St. Basil to lead us in an opening prayer.
Let's pray. For those of us who work and serve at the University of St. Michael's College, we pray to you, O Most Holy Spirit, to keep us ever attentive to the privileged way that we have been called to serve you and to take our place in promoting the mission of the Church. Inspire us to work tirelessly for the dignity and the freedom of the mind and of the implications of our knowledge and understanding. Let us seek to know the truth wherever it is to be found. We thank you for the gift and blessing of Mary Hess to this university. Bless her work, and bless this university. May we never forget our mission to serve our students through your gifts, O Most Holy Spirit, of knowledge and understanding. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Father. Before we begin, we wish to acknowledge this land on which the University of Toronto and also the University of St. Michael's College operates. For thousands of years, it has been a traditional land of the Huron, Wendat, the Seneca, and most recently, the Mississaugas of the Credit River. Today, this meeting place is still the home to many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island, and we are grateful to have the opportunity to work on this land. We honor this land's original peoples, and we invite others also to think about the past and present-day realities of those communities, and to holistically question colonial practices that disrupt connections to family, homes, and the earth. Tonight, it is my distinct pleasure to introduce Dr. Mary Hess, who holds the Visiting Patrick and Barbara Keenan Chair in Religious Education in the Faculty of Theology. The Faculty of Theology reinstated this endowed chair after it had not been filled for some years, and we decided that an effective way to revive the chair was to begin with one-year visiting professorships. Each year, the faculty would invite a leading scholar in the field to hold the chair and complete research. We also invited the scholar to teach one course for our Masters of Religious Education program. And finally, we would ask the holder of this chair to present a public lecture about their research. And Dr. Hess, we are very pleased to say, is our inaugural holder of the Keenan Chair. Before I speak about Dr. Hess, I do want to acknowledge that Mrs. Barbara Keenan and her daughter, Ms. Gwen Harvey, have joined us tonight. It gives me the opportunity to thank the Keenan Foundation publicly for its initial donation that created the endowed chair, but more importantly for their support for our plans to revive it. The Faculty of Theology is honored by your trust in us, and so our goal is to respond to your generosity and support by faithfully fulfilling our mandate to form Catholic educators theologically and pastorally so they may become more effective teachers. By bringing in visiting scholars over the next few years, we will be exposing our students, as well as ourselves, to some of the major research and teaching trends in religious education. And by the time we decide upon a permanent holder of this chair, we will have a clearer understanding of how we can enhance our Master of Religious Education degree in significant ways. In this context, it is my pleasure here to announce that the holder of the Visiting Keenan Chair for 2017-18 will be Dr. Mara Brecht of St. Norbert's College. Dr. Brecht is a theologian who is engaged in Catholic education in the context of interreligious dialogue and the challenges of racial and cultural privilege in North American educational system. We look forward to working with her next year. But for now, we have been enjoying our time with Dr. Hess. Dr. Hess came to us from Luther Seminary in St. Paul, Minnesota, where she is professor of educational leadership. She holds a BA from Yale University and a Master's of Theological Studies from Harvard University. She then traveled a few miles down the road to pursue a doctoral degree in religion and education at Boston College and completed that program under the careful watch of Dr. Mary Boyce. She has spent the last 17 years at Luther Seminary. And I have to admit that when the Faculty of Theology was considering Dr. Hess for this position, we were all impressed that she clearly embraced ecumenism, as she was a Catholic theologian who engaged Lutheran scholars and students on a daily basis. And she liked it. But what we found most attractive was her area of research, namely the intersection of religious education and social media. Dr. Hess has engaged that role, has engaged the role that social media can play in religious education since its emergence about a decade ago. She was well positioned to do so since her initial interests have been in the role media literacy can play in education. Her specialist training as both a theologian and as an educator ensured that her approach to these issues would be nuanced and sophisticated. Her own creativity, however, and her personal perspectives ensured that her scholarship was always grounded in the needs of the ecclesial communities in which she worked. It is this specific aspect of Dr. Hess as a theologian that I have personally appreciated. I have to admit that I had an ulterior motive in recommending Dr. Hess to her to be our inaugural chairholder. As a new dean, I've been committed to finding ways to make our well-respected MRE program even better and broaden its accessibility through online tools. And so I've been so grateful that I've been able to seek Dr. Hess's advice on how to do this effectively, knowing that her recommendation and even her critiques were grounded in good practice. That technical and experiential knowledge has been wonderful to draw from. But what has been more compelling for me is that in those conversations, they have revealed a Catholic theologian who wants to provide ways for Catholic men and women to discover their faith, to discover a faith that speaks to their own internal questions, that seeks to address the social and political challenges in our society, that engages each person who creates, shares, and believes. That desire to help men and women understand their faith so they may experience the triune God is born both of the heartache that some have encountered within the church, and so the need to be called back to the community, and the wonder that faith generates that those members of the ecclesial community can enjoy. And I say enjoy in the Augustinian sense of the word. Now I will stop there with my faulty description of Dr. Hess's work so that she can better tell us about her research. And so I now invite her to give her paper, which is the topic of a book she is currently preparing, Create, Share, Believe, Storing Faith in a Post-Church World. Mary, welcome.
I need to start by sharing my profound gratitude for the generosity of the donors who've made this chair possible, and the faculty and the institution who have welcomed me so thoroughly. I am deeply thankful to all of you. I also want to point out that there's a handout available tonight, and I've given you a link at the top of that handout to the slides I'm using. So if there are things you'd like to note or follow up on, you can find the slides at that link, and it includes the URLs for the two videos we're going to see it later tonight. So now, Storing Faith in a Post-Church World. I chose this title for two reasons in particular. First, because most of my research in the past two decades has centered around how stories shape our religious practices. Stories from within our traditions, but perhaps even more so in this day and age, stories which come to us from many other places. And second, because what it means to live in a post-church world is a little bit provocative. I hope so, at least. So what do I mean by a post-church? Let me start, like all stories do, in this way. Oops. Once upon a time, a little girl grew up surrounded by a family of faith. Born into a Catholic family, blessed from baptism on with Catholics who helped her gain a sense of herself in the midst of the church, this little girl's life was laid out well in front of her. She went to school in an explicitly Catholic setting, surrounded by other Catholics. She was immersed in a rich set of practices, both in school, in liturgy, at home. She learned how to say novenas, how to recite the creeds, how to participate in liturgy. She participated in reconciliation regularly. She loved the silence of the adoration of the Blessed Sacrament. She enjoyed dressing up for her first communion, and so on. This child knew where she belonged, knew what to wear, she knew what to do and what not to do. Most of the time she revered her parents, most of the time she was awed by her priest. As she grew up, she participated in Catholic youth organizations, went on pilgrimage. You know the story. And it's a lovely story. And like all stories, there's a lot of truth to it. But what if I told the story this way? Once upon a time, a little girl was born into a Catholic family. This family was large, and immigration was a central part of its shared story. This little girl had relatives all over the world, and in the city in which she lived, she had friends from many different cultures and many different religions. Her parents had moved away from their families of origin and married in spite of some of their family's concern, since they came from different parts of the world. Her parents told her stories from both of their family traditions and worked hard to help her learn respect for all religions, but they were busy and often beset by competing commitments. So while her parents grew up immersed in specific religious traditions, this little girl grew up surrounded by the stories of popular culture, the vivid music shared with her friends, the compelling stories found on YouTube and in movie theaters. She and her parents went to church, but aside from that routine, they had little direct participation with religious institutions. Their only contact with religious stories was usually refracted through popular culture, or the residue of religion they remembered from their childhood. This little girl grew up knowing that her parents believed she was capable of following her dreams, and she looked forward to making her way in the world, but she didn't necessarily have a clear path. Both of these stories can be told about a young woman growing up here in Toronto, but the first story is much rarer, while the second story is so common I'm guessing it's familiar to you. It's the second story that leads me to want to talk with you about a post-church world. When I use that term, I'm not saying that there are no churches in the world or even that I would want to work towards such a world. I'm simply noticing that we can no longer take for granted a degree of religious socialization, of immersion and shared practice that helps people to grow into faith in the midst of a community almost without conscious effort. In the first story, what is the role of the religious educator? We can talk about that role in many ways, as catechist, as director of religious education, as content specialist in a school. But in each case, the religious educator is free to focus on exploring specific elements of a specific faith, supporting the memorization, for instance, of details, or offering critical engagement with doctrine. These are teaching roles that build on an existing formation, that assume a community of shared practice. In the second story, the role of the religious educator is much more complicated. How do you do religious education when you are immersed in a vibrant fabric of difference, when there are multiple faiths competing for your attention, and when information about religion is often offered by people and institutions who are even at times hostile to specific faiths? Even a content specialist in a secondary school that is explicitly Catholic is not teaching only Catholics. And the array of what constitutes Catholic practice stretches across multiple cultures, languages, even continents in the same family. So we are facing what Ron Heifetz calls an adaptive challenge. He uses that term in contrast with another, a technical challenge, to call attention to this reality. So what is he getting at? A technical challenge is clear. There's consensus about the problem being faced, and there's an obvious solution. The primary effort necessary is to implement the solution as effectively and as efficiently as possible. Think about the simple break of a bone. An X-ray shows the break, it's clear what's necessary to fix it, and what a patient needs to do is precisely that, exercise patience, while having a technically skilled person set the bone properly. An adaptive challenge, however, is more like going to a doctor with a persistent stomach ache and having the doctor tell you that it's not clear what's wrong. Maybe your diet needs to change. Maybe some medication would help. Maybe your workplace is causing you deep anxiety. In this case, you, as the patient, have to be an active partner with your doctor in discerning what's wrong and learning how to fix it. Or if it's not easily fixed, adapt to it. We are living in a time, in a world, in societies in which change is all around us. And in religious education in particular, we are being tempted towards technical solutions. Here are the 10 best practices, or here's the right curriculum for a school district. Here's the practice to implement in your parish, rather than to some of the deeper questions. Many of us are finding ourselves drawn by our fears into pulling in the borders of our religious institutions and seeking to reassure ourselves that if we just hold on to these 10 rules or this creed or this catechism, all will be well. But we need instead to find what is necessary to inhabit adaptive change. We need to dig deeply into our tradition to glean the patterns and the practices that support such adaptation. And we need to discern the risks of falling into technical traps. John Roberto is a Catholic educator who's been working with us, with religious educators, for decades to find ways to engage these adaptive challenges. He founded the Center for Ministry Development in Connecticut. Maybe some of you know his work there. And for the last several years, he's been involved with the Faith 2020 project. He's asking all of us to consider what faith may look like in the future based on the trends in place right now and their implications for that future. I commend you all his work, and there's a link on the handout actually to Lifelong Faith. Most of his stuff is online. But for now, allow me to share with you a key element of his process. Surveying the empirical research on trends in religious traditions, in religious institutions, in human development, and so on, he's identified two specific trajectories that are embedded in much of this research and has offered us the following diagram. So consider these two spectra of possible futures for religious institution and religious identity. One spectrum begins with a very low hunger for spirituality and stretches horizontally across the graph to a point of high hunger. The other spectrum is placed on the vertical and stretches from strong resistance to religious institutions up to a high point of strong receptivity to religious institutions. The intersection of these two trends offer us four possible scenarios for what might be unfolding. And here, Roberto's argument is not so much a prediction, but rather a catalyst for our imagination. For instance, we have a quadrant at the top here, where people have both a high hunger for spirituality and a strong receptivity to religious institutions. And I have a hunch that many of us in this room have found ourselves in that quadrant at some point or another in our lives. In the lower right quadrant, we can imagine a space in which people have both a high hunger for spirituality, but also a strong resistance to religious institutions. And by now, you're probably familiar with the spiritual but not religious category. There are two more possibilities, however. The lower left quadrant is a space in which a low hunger for spirituality is combined with a strong resistance to religious institutions. And in the upper left quadrant is a space in which a low hunger for spirituality is combined with a strong receptivity to religious institutions. Most of us in religious education have focused our attention in the upper right quadrant and utterly failed to develop strategies for the other three spaces. Even the upper left, this is the strongly receptive but not very hungry group, most of us might be familiar with a group of people labeled the Christmas and Easter Christians. This is a group of people that we still often don't know how to reach. Yet if you consider the trajectories, the trends of where we are right now, these three quadrants are growing, and the one upon which we are focusing our attention is shrinking. And I think there's something worth noting there. Christianity, to speak from my very specific context, emerged during a time of great change, and over the centuries has consistently adapted to local conditions. It's a remarkably resilient and transforming faith. It's rich with resources for finding the courage and the integrity to be adaptive. But that very adaptivity holds lessons through time. Because there are moments and places and ways and means in which we have found ourselves falling into dangerous patterns. Times when we reached for technical solutions and in the process walked directly away from the deep relationship that God was extending to us. Consider the original community of the followers of Jesus. These people, particularly those labeled Gentiles, essentially fell in love with another people's God, to use Willie Jennings' phrase. They were welcomed into a community that was wide open and inclusive. As the Apostle Paul notes in his first letter to the community of Corinth, he comes knowing nothing but Christ and him crucified. That story was the center of their lives together. This is a story of faith that's born in an overwhelming love and that embodies that love in communal sharing and practice. This early community fed itself on that love and shared amongst itself powerful stories of love that went even beyond the grave. We have hundreds of stories of martyrs, for instance, testimonies offered of a relationship with God so clear and so compelling that they willingly faced death rather than renege on that relationship. Such a stance was inordinately powerful, and as such, it provoked fear and anxiety in some people. Those of us who are Catholic, tracing our practice all the way back to Peter, need to recognize how often our church has gotten into trouble when it lived from that fear rather than resisting it, when we sought technical solutions to what are clearly adaptive challenges. In the 4th century, Constantine aligned Christianity with the state at the point of a sword, and thus began a long journey fraught with the seductions of power that was power over, rather than power poured out in canonic love. That was a technical solution. Let's just turn everyone into Christians, rather than living into the messiness of the adaptive challenges faced by a community witnessing to divine, transcendent love. We are just now commemorating the 500th anniversary of the Reformation, another moment in our church's history when competing commitments clashed, when competing definitions of Christian practice fought each other at the point of a sword. I have to admit to being grateful to that Catholic monk, Martin Luther, who helped to make Christian practice and belief accessible in daily ways through the use of vernacular languages, popular songs, family-based learning. But I also want to learn from what he ignited, much of it very negative, when orthodoxy took pride of place over orthopraxy. Martin Luther took early advantage of the printing press, and he made scripture and religious belief accessible in ways never before imagined. But at the same time, and this is Richard Rohr's observation, he catalyzed a movement which walked steadily away from the contemplative traditions of Christianity, from the communion in difference vision of the early Jesus movements. In each of these moments in time, people of faith faced the challenge of what it meant to be Christian in their daily lives and what it meant to do so at a time of widely varying interpretations. I believe we're in another such moment, a moment Elizabeth Drescher has called a digital reformation. We are at a time in which religious educators must step outside of our comfort zones and remember what our central beliefs actually call us to. As Pope Francis reminds us, we can see the world through the lens of our common home and of love poured out, of humility and mercy. Or we can retreat back into our anxious places of fortress religion. In this moment, I'm convinced that one of our most powerful urges as human beings supports us in this kind of adaptive resilience. And in the rest of my time tonight, I want to walk through what it means to story faith. Because human beings are creatures caught up in stories. We live by stories. We understand ourselves through the stories we tell. And as Jesus knew and taught, we have powerful stories in which to immerse ourselves. And we are living in a time of stories, in some ways what critics have called a renaissance of stories. I'm convinced that God is speaking to us in the midst of these stories, and often more in the stories offered to us even in popular culture and shared via the web than sometimes those told in church, because quite frankly, fewer and fewer people are finding themselves in church these days. So what would it mean for religious educators to begin from the clear conviction that God continues to reveal God's self to us? What would it mean for us to base our search and any interpretive stances we care to use on the conviction that God is a trinity, a communicative relationship within God's very self and in communicative relationship with us, with all of creation? And if we see God that way, must we also see ourselves that way? Given that we so often get it wrong, given the reality of sin in the world, what helps us to do good discernment? What are the practices and the theological waypoints that help us towards this? And how do we do this in ways that ignite curiosity and wonder in the midst of everyday practices? Story is at the heart of all of these challenges. But not simply the stories we tell about ourselves or the stories we tell about religious institutions, rather, it's the stories we tell that weave these stories together, and further that weave our stories with God's stories. So how do we go from personal stories to shared institutional stories, or vice versa? And how do we tell these stories, embody them, live within them, in ways that invite us to be all the more passionately centered in God's love, and thus drawn out of ourselves and into deep compassion with the world? To begin with, we need to allow ourselves to see what is happening all around us. We need to, quote, read the signs of the times with eyes wide open and hearts bowed down. Three shifts that are taking place all around us due to digital media are these: shifts in how we understand authority, what we mean by authenticity, and how we experience agency. We can no longer rely on structural or institutional forms of authority to function without dynamic commitments to building and sharing that authority, to telling the stories which make that authority become bound up with our own personal stories. My standard example here is that the most authoritative documents in the Catholic Church were generally understood to be pronounced first in Latin and then shared down through local bishops' conferences for the contextualization and translation necessary before coming to the ears and eyes of lay people. This is a process that took very seriously the necessity of contextualization, of rooting church teaching in the contexts, languages, and cultures of communities of faith. But now, in 2017, documents such as papal encyclicals, which are understood by our church to carry a very high degree of authority, are placed on the web in multiple languages. And people first hear of them through commercial news outlets, interpreters who are most, for the most part, entirely outside of the church. So consider, when did you first encounter Evangelii Gaudium or Laudato Si? Perhaps, if you're an upper right quadrant person, you heard that a document was being released and you went directly to the Vatican website. More of us probably first caught a glimpse of that document in a news report. And very few of us first encountered the document through our local bishop. We are living in a time which anthropologist Michael Wesch notes is a time of context collapse. Hence, authority is no longer structural or institutionally experienced in the carefully hierarchical way it might once have been. Instead, authority is largely shaped by two other dynamics: what we mean by authenticity, and how we experience agency. And you'll probably not be surprised to learn that millions of dollars are spent every year, both here and in the States, trying to determine what is authentic and how to sell us on that particular definition. Increasingly, people rely on their own experience and those of people close to them to determine the authenticity of a particular message. My dictionary suggests that authentic has to do with, quote, relating to or denoting an emotionally appropriate, significant, purposive, and responsible mode of human life. For many people, what is authentic is determined in part by its opposite. If you feel manipulated by something or someone, you tend not to see that as being authentic. Here an example might be asking what constitutes authentic liturgy. Ask one of my liturgy prof friends, and the answer will likely entail a particular rubric and the extent to which that liturgical event is congruent with that rubric. If you ask some of my younger students, the answer will always be, because it felt right to me. Here the dictionary connotation of emotionally significant comes through in their response. When authority is so strongly shaped by elements of authenticity, we can find ourselves in a situation where a leader might assert with great passion and conviction something that is factually false, but which people accept as true. Sound familiar? I imagine you can think of many such examples, and not simply from the States. We have a challenge here in the church, because we have to find ways of building credibility for the truth, capital T, which we confess. We cannot take for granted, though, that simply asserting it as true is going to feel authentic to people. On the other hand, and this is really where I rest in all of this, we have the assurance of the Holy Spirit that the truth will set us free, that we are always accompanied by the Spirit. We know that even in the midst of context collapse, we can be assured that we are held by the Spirit. So authority, authenticity. The third dynamic, which media studies research lifts up, is that of agency. So what do I mean by agency? Agency, a quick way to describe it would be knowledge in action. It's the ability to make something happen, to do something. In much of the rest of what I have to say tonight, I will be talking about the ways in which digital media support personal agency, as well as forms of collaborative agency. But I need to mark first that from a Christian perspective, we have to begin and end with a deep conviction that the prime agent, the primary form of agency, right, is of course God. Everything begins and continues and ends with God. Understanding how human agency is wound up with divine agency, how our stories are intermingled with God's story, is at the heart of theological reflection. And in fact, one of my favorite books, which is listed on the handout, is by Catholic priest Ed Foley and his pastoral care theologian partner Herbert Anderson. The book is called Mighty Stories, Dangerous Rituals, Weaving Together the Human and the Divine. So what does it mean to weave together the human and the divine? How do we do so with careful attention to our humanness in that relationship, but also to God's transcendent power? And here, although he doesn't know I'm doing this, I want to remind us of some of what Dr. D'Souza told us in an earlier lecture this year. His work in the philosophy of education offers important alignment and resonance to what I need to say here. He said then, the unfathomable and the true are inseparable. That language is an indispensable means of encountering the real and reality. That the natural habitat of truth is human conversation. And he pointed there and in much of his work to Lonergan's principles, be attentive, be intelligent, be reasonable, be responsible. These are assertions that emerge as well from some of what I think is the most interesting and important work in theology in the past several years, theology which seeks to find new relevance and meaning in exploring the Trinity. This is a new story of the Trinity, or perhaps one retrieved from the ancient past. Catherine Maria Lacuna, She of Blessed Rest, Elizabeth Johnson, Jochen Hilberoth, Matthias Scherer, these are all Catholic theologians whose imagination has been captivated by considering anew the mystery of the Trinity. Stephen Bevins puts it, the communion in difference, which can be evoked by a confession of God as communicative within God's very self, as relational within God's very being, and then by extension, communicative and relational with all of creation. So why does telling God's story in this way matter so much? It's not simply that the Trinity is a mystery beyond compare, although that's not a bad reason, but it's that telling the story of who God is in this way privileges communication and relationality. Seeing who we are through the lens of the Trinity ignites new wonder and curiosity about human communication too, and invites both a retrieval and a reimagining of the stories at the heart of our faith. If shifts in our form of communication, if a digital reformation, to use Drescher's terms, are pressing upon us, then finding ways to perceive how our communicative practices are at risk, perhaps even under siege, is thoroughly important, not only for theologians, but for religious educators. Remember the Roberto scenarios I mentioned earlier? How might focusing on communication practices help us understand and reach out to people who have little hunger for spirituality? Or for those who have some hunger, but also have high resistance to religious institutions? Think about this list, which has been offered as descriptive of how people growing up immersed in digital media perceive organizations. All ideas compete on an equal footing. Contribution counts for more than credentials. Hierarchies are natural, not prescribed. Leaders serve rather than preside. Tasks are chosen, not assigned. Groups are self-defining and self-organizing. Resources get attracted, not allocated. Power comes from sharing information, not hoarding it. Opinions compound and decisions are peer-reviewed. Users can veto most policy decisions. Intrinsic rewards matter most. And hackers are heroes. These are a set of attributes identified as being integral to a generation raised in the midst of social media, what Hamel calls the Facebook generation. They indicate a high degree of personal agency and autonomy. And notice how far from our standard, maybe even normative, Catholic practices these are. Yet more and more people are immersed in settings in which these are the dominant practices. So what's fascinating to me is that viewed from a different angle, viewed from a different understanding of how we know, told through a different story about knowing, the set of practices is actually not all that different. What do I mean by that? All right, consider these two images of knowing, what in theological contexts we call epistemology. The one on the left describes a world in which static objects are observed by experts who then transmit their observations to amateurs who are entirely apart, even isolated from the static object under study. The model on the right attempts to describe a world in which a dynamic subject, so not simply a topic at the center, but a subject that has agency, is embedded in a set of relationships such that every knower has a direct relationship with that subject and also with every other knower. Knowing, in the model on the left, is solely dependent on the skills and wisdom of the expert. Knowing, in the model on the right, is thoroughly interdependent with an environment which makes that kind of engagement possible. In the model on the right, the more diverse the knowers who are engaged in shared knowing, the more robust that knowing can be. You might be surprised to learn that the model on the right, a model which Parker Palmer has labeled the community of truth, is a model retrieved from the ancient desert mothers and fathers, and also a model which aligns with how contemporary physicists describe knowing. So let's go back to that list. All ideas compete on an equal footing. Can we think about this statement through the community of truth? It's important to note that in this model, the competition of ideas requires that ideas remain connected to the centered subject. For an idea to be in competition, if you will, for our understanding of reality, it needs to remain in touch with that reality. This is not a description of relativism, but rather a way of understanding knowing that can encompass complexity, that can be humbled by postmodern insight, but remain attached to a desire for truth. From that perspective, seen through that lens, then indeed all ideas might compete on an equal footing because all ideas are nested in some way in the midst of that web of relationality. All are connected to the subject at the center and all are in relation to each other. But it's actually less about competition and more about the ecology or the fabric of knowing. What about contribution counts for more than credentials? In the Christian community, we have long believed, affirmed, confessed, witnessed to this assertion. Or what else did the Beatitudes mean? Or the admonition not to flaunt ourselves in prayer? Or Jesus' declaration that we must become like children to enter the kingdom of God? That next item in the list of generational characteristics, that hierarchies are natural, not prescribed, might appear to contradict the heart, at least of my church's way of knowing. But actually, on one level, it's an essential understanding of hierarchy within the church. To say that it is natural, not prescribed, is to point to the ways in which hierarchies arise in the world due to the necessity of clarifying the wisdom of groups. That is to say, on Reddit or any of a number of other digital sites, wisdom rises to the top through a complicated process of voting up or down, of using electronic algorithms to sort through vast oceans of data to lift up emerging consensuses. Sound familiar? Maybe not. But I believe that these are contemporary ways of embodying a process that can have enormous resonance with something our teaching magisterium sought to capture in the language of the sensus fidelium. So too the language of leaders serve rather than preside. Setting aside for the moment what the technical language of presiding and liturgy means, the Bible and our tradition are full of language and examples of what it means to be a servant leader. I could do this kind of interpretation for each of the rest of the items on the list, but the overall point I want to make is that there may in fact be much within our tradition and worldview which resonates with the generation shaped through Facebook. If only we are astute enough to give people socialized within those frameworks access to the deep bones of our community, a community which has followed Jesus through more than two millennia. If indeed we are understanding knowing in the complex, full-bodied, and wholehearted way that Palmer reminds us, the community of truth, then we have vibrant opportunities in front of us. And here's where a Trinitarian understanding really comes alive. For confessing God as Trinity is a confession of deep commitment to communicative practice, deep commitment to relational understanding, deep commitment to wading into the heart of the adaptive challenges facing us in digital media, and doing so with profound hope and faith. We are made in the image of God. We are then made in the image of communication and relationality. So how do we do theology in this way? At a minimum, I believe this means that we in the church cannot refuse to be thoroughly present in digital media, and the Vatican actually leads the way here because both Pope Benedict and Pope Francis have been using Twitter, Instagram, and other digital media for some time now. The various World Communications Day messages, and I put the links on the handout, going back all the way to John Paul II, engage digital media as elements of human meaning-making. But these messages also variously remind us that it's not enough simply to be present. We need to bring our commitments, our perspectives, our creativity to these spaces. Indeed, being made in the image of God suggests to me that there are three very specific ways in which we are being invited to be present in the midst of digital media. I entitled this lecture, Create, Share, Believe, for a very specific reason. I think these three elements of the dynamic dance of Trinity must be part of our commitments in religious education. We believe in the God who creates everything. Creative action is clearly a part of who God is and who we, being made in God's image, are. We believe in a God who shares God's very being into the world through incarnation. Again, sharing is very much a part of who we are. And we believe in a God who continues to be very much present to us, breathing through the Holy Spirit, drawing us ever closer into communion, ever more deeply into belief. Create, share, believe. This is a circle dance, and I fear that far too many of us as religious educators have focused exclusively on entering this dance through the doorway of belief. There's, of course, nothing wrong with entering the dance in that way, but I believe there is something wrong with only doing so through that doorway. And I have seen this clearly and strongly in the midst of my own practices of religious education. Years ago, I started working with digital storytelling and discovered that it's a profoundly powerful entry point into this dance. Digital storytelling, at least as practiced in the ways in which I and the global movement of educators who use it do so, is a workshop-based, participatory media practice focused on self-representation. So what does that mean? I'm going to show you an example in a minute, but basically it means that when we do digital storytelling, we begin with people gathered in a circle in person, and with particular care to the structure of the conversation, invite them to tell stories from their lives. Story matters, and digital storytelling begins with story. Once someone has articulated a narrative they want to use, we then work with them to add pictures, photos, sometimes a music track, layering meaning into the story to deepen it. Doing so takes time. And any of you who have ever tried to make a digital video will know something of how you can get caught up in fussing with specific elements, returning over and over again to a short stretch of the story, pausing to refine it. Of course, once you've done this kind of work, you generally end up with something you want to share. Creativity tends to work that way. Creating something takes time, care, reflection, and the energy of completion pushes the creator to share it. When we do digital storytelling as faith formation, we share the videos people have created, at least with each other in the workshop and often out into the world through Vimeo or YouTube. And here's the fascinating insight. Creating and sharing something in this way almost inevitably leads to deeper belief. in part, I suspect, because of the care and attention that goes into crafting a story in the first place. Doing this kind of digital creation requires slowing down, returning again and again to the details of what you are creating. It's a form of discernment, even. So create, share, believe. In every quadrant of which Roberto writes, we can do this work. But I find it particularly fruitful in the upper right-hand quadrant because telling stories in that place often draws out evidence of how a deep hunger for spirituality can be met with the rich resources of religious institutions. People in that upper right-hand quadrant tend to have databases of religious meaning to draw upon as they build their stories, and of course, sharing such stories with people who share that hunger, but not get the receptivity to religious institutions, can be infectious. Bridges of shared meaning are more easily built between the upper right and the lower right quadrants of that matrix. Years ago, I first encountered the work of Jochen Hilberop, who was then at Tübingen, and Matthias Scherer, who was at the University of Innsbruck. The two of them have been inviting theological reflection through a specific process that they have labeled communicative theology, and again, the citation's on the handout. What their process has in common with mine in digital storytelling is that it seeks to create a vibrant dance of communication, of relationship between the I, the person telling the story, the we, the community in which that story is shared, but also the it, which is an unfortunate piece of the way they talk about this, which is the logos, really, of our faith, and doing so in the midst of what they term the globe. That is, they pay very careful attention to context. And they do so with very specific care, very intentional care for the processes, the pedagogies that they employ. They argue that theology at its best is precisely this, the dance between these elements. And I want to share with you one example of this kind of storytelling, a story that was created in a workshop I led a little while ago. And I'm going to ask for Catherine to turn off the lights, because I think you'll be able to see it better that way.
I grew up on Wonder Bread. It was what my family could afford. One loaf could feed our family far more inexpensively than a designer loaf from a bakery. Peanut butter and jelly, bologna with mayonnaise. But over the years, I've come to disdain cheap white bread as unhealthy, and, I'm ashamed to admit, lower-class fare. So that day, I was dismayed to see the slices of white bread laid out on the communion table in our seminary chapel. Could anything feel more incongruent with the soaring Gothic architecture of the chapel that represented my high church leanings? Usually, we used beautiful homemade loaves of crusty, wholesome grains when we served communion. I sat in my pew, conflicted, trying to figure out why this felt so disturbing. I loved the sacrament of communion. I just didn't love this bread. It was as though my child self was in that pre-sliced white bread, and I didn't know what to do with that. Then it came to me. I had only been permitted to start taking communion when I was 13 years old. I'd never been permitted to bring my child self to the table. But that day in the seminary chapel, that wonder bread on the table ushered my child self in and invited her to partake of the grace offered at this holy meal. As we went forward to receive the bread, I reached out my hand, and as the server said, "This is the body of Christ broken for you," the broken places of my childhood seemed to inhabit that small piece of torn white wonder bread. Brokenness shared, somehow, has healing power. I'll never look at wonder bread the same way.
So this is an example of a digital story created by someone deeply steeped in the upper right-hand quadrant of Roberto's scenarios. In my experience, it's also a story that draws people towards the language of faith. There are other ways to engage story, however, and I want to offer at least one other, which is proving very fruitful in various contexts of religious education. This example involves using theological reflection with materials drawn from popular culture. For instance, what might we do with a television commercial? Patricia O'Connell Killen has a process that she calls the art of theological reflection, which has been in use in many different places for a couple of decades now. I like to use her process with television commercials, and I'm going to actually invite you to try it tonight, at least the first part of it. We'll only get a taste of it, but I think that it will give you a taste that might encourage you to try it at more length. So I'm going to begin by sharing a piece of pop culture with you. In this case, I'm going to show you a Canadian television commercial. And while you watch it, I want you to pay attention to what feelings are being evoked, just for you. There's no right or wrong about this. Just be open to whatever the feelings are. And I'm not going to ask you to share it with anybody next to you. So just for yourself, think about what the feelings are. You might even want to jot them down for a minute. Okay, so now I need the lights again. Describes what you were feeling as you watched this commercial. The next thing you do is you take those adjectives, hopefully maybe you even came up with more than one, and see if there's any kind of cluster around them. You know, do the words that come to mind express a particular theme to you? They all sort of cluster in a particular place? Maybe there's even an image that emerges for you, but the issue is there might be a theme. Okay. So now sit with that theme for a moment. Can you think about how God might be present and calling to you from it? You might ask yourself, what is life-giving and joyful about it? Or you might ask, what is broken and sorrowing about it? Or you might think about what possibilities for healing and newness exist within it. These are actually core questions in theological reflection, and you can follow them into the Bible, into the tradition. And this would be the place at which what I would do, I'd be asking people to brainstorm what emerges for them. Of course, in a group that lives in the upper right-hand quadrant, there's probably a lot that emerges. For a group that's not in that quadrant, not as much emerges, right? So that's a piece that we would work with. And once we found a passage, so you take your theme, right? Think about what is emerging for you in it, then think about what resonates with it from scripture or tradition. Then you would go to that place, whether it's a scripture passage, or it's an element of a liturgy, or it's a part of a hymn, you would go and find it. Where is it? What's in that, right? So you see more of the context around it. And again, in that space now, so in the biblical passage, or the hymn, or the piece that's emerged for you, you ask the same questions that you asked earlier. What is life-giving and joy-filled? What is broken and sorrowing? What possibilities for healing and new life exist within it? All right. Killen suggests two more steps to the process, and on the back of your handout is actually the full process laid out as steps. These are steps, so her additional steps, invite a recognition of God's agency woven into your own personal agency, and I commend these steps to you. But for now, I'll just stop this exercise right here. But I hope that you can begin to see that even a television commercial, a piece of pop culture that is very determinedly secular, can be a rich resource for theological reflection. And notice, too, that this is a process that can slow us down. It's a process which creates room for silence, for introspection, and I would do it in a lot longer span of time in some settings, for listening to what's welling up within you, and for reflecting upon those feelings in light of the deep bones of our tradition. What is life-giving and joy-filled? What is broken and sorrowing? What offers possibilities of healing and newness? This is language that invites resonance with biblical stories without assuming a linear one-to-one match. It's a language that invites recontextualization within our tradition. We may be experiencing context collapse, but we can recontextualize. A process such as this uses easily accessible language, language of joy and sorrow, of healing and newness, while drawing on very profound theological commitments. Killen's process builds from a very robust theology of grace and a profound conviction that God is always reaching out to us in everything and in every way, that our own human thirst for meaning is in fact a thirst for God, a God who is intimately caring and passionately involved in our lives. This process assumes that revelation is ongoing, intimately touching our daily lives, while at the same time, it's historically privileged in the Gospels and in the theological heritage of the Church. This is a conviction that rests on the utter certainty that we are inescapably wrapped up in a community of truth. We need not fear. We need not build fortresses around our convictions. We can lean on them. We can lean into them. We can lean outward into the world which God has created. This is actually a pretty empowering story. And this kind of work with a digital story, plumbing the riches of pop culture, can very often be a way into the two other quadrants from Roberto's Matrix. People who are open to religious institutions but have little hunger for spirituality, and people who have a high hunger for spirituality but also major resistance to religious institutions. This kind of experience builds authority and credibility for religious meaning-making by drawing on experiential elements and inviting them into conversation with religious ideas. Further, it invites meaning-making, which is at once both very personal and also connected to religious institutions. Both of these kinds of digital stories, those we work on by crafting personal narratives and putting them into digital formats and sharing them out to the world, and those which come from taking pieces of secular culture and inviting them into religious discernment, both of these practices are built upon a core conviction that knowing is shaped deeply by community and that it carries both personal and communal elements to it, that we participate in a community of truth, to use Palmer's language. Religious education in this time and in these places, religious education in the 21st century, must take seriously the adaptive challenges we are facing. We must, as religious educators, recognize these shifts in authority and authenticity and agency, and accept that God is meeting us in the midst of them. I'm convinced that digital storytelling is an essential practice of faith formation in the world we inhabit. First, as a personal practice mediated by a social workshop, you saw the Wonder Bread story. Second, as outreach and accompaniment in the midst of popular culture, as with the commercial. And it's not a coincidence that I chose those two specific stories as examples, because I believe they offer rich testimony to the table fellowship, which is at the heart of Catholic practice. I'm not saying that was Eucharist, right? I'm saying that what Eucharist draws on are these stories of table fellowship. In creating spaces to share our beliefs, we are embodying some of the most effective forms of religious education available today. Effective because they invite us into wonder and curiosity. Effective because they can be a spur to long-time learning. And effective because the explicit, implicit, and null curricula all come together in ways that embody God's active presence and ongoing revelation. I would be the last person to argue that digital storytelling is the only necessary process within religious education, but I do believe it's a practice uniquely suited to the era we find ourselves in. So as I draw my reflections to a close, let's return to the stories I began with. The two young girls, one immersed in deep Catholic community, one learning amid the chaotic ebb and flow of pluralism. Seeing through the lenses of communicative practice, seeing through the lenses of Trinitarian theology, offers hope in both cases. Nothing I've said here tonight takes away from or refutes the practices surrounding the first girl and her story. In many ways, what I've said reinforces the power and immediacy of such practices. Deeper theological reflection may well bring her to the kind of realization that my digital storyteller did as she reclaimed her child self in the midst of the celebration of communion. But this is also true of the second story, and here is the difference. We have to recognize that that second little girl's parents, grandparents, the adults around her, are essential in helping her to learn the stories of this God whom we confess. Which means that finding ways to encourage and nurture those adults, finding ways to ignite their curiosity about the stories at the heart of Christian faith, becomes an urgent and crucial task. And this is not a task that can be imposed from above, or that can be practiced by using only narrow or constricting definitions. At a minimum, we need to recognize that there are stories all around us that can be drawn on, that can ignite curiosity and bring us more deeply into the tradition. Just as a commercial for a grocery store can do for many people, given some space and room to consider it. God continues to speak. God continues to reveal God's self all around us, and in us, and through us, and that includes the music, the film, the TV, the YouTube videos that we've watched. This communication requires reflection. It certainly requires discernment, but it's a communicative practice that has legs, that has traction, even in the midst of some very challenging times. And helping young people to learn in these ways, which means helping religious educators to teach in these ways, has rippled far beyond our own communities. Father Fisichella, the president of the Pontifical Council for the Promotion of the New Evangelization, made precisely this point to me more than a year ago when I spoke with him in Rome. He spoke at length and eloquently about the new evangelization being at heart about listening carefully to people as we accompany them in their daily lives. We must, as religious educators, listen carefully, and particularly to the adults in our midst, about the struggles, the heartaches, the joys, and the sorrows that they are living through. No question is too big, no sorrow too small, to wonder with them about where and how God is revealing that self. These are the stories which form the fabric of our belief. And entering the circle dance of creating, sharing, and believing through these stories can and will invite us ever more deeply into the mystery of God. Thank you.